to start?
Start?
Yes, sir, we can start.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. I have great pleasure in welcoming you all for today's Gurukul session on slipped capital femoral epiphysis. As usual, before going on to the lecture proper, we shall have a small pretest to just to brush up the knowledge about slipped capital femoral epiphysis, and later on, today's guru is going to give a detailed lecture. So I'm going to launch a poll now. I request all the participants to vote. The first question is, which of the following hormone does not influence the growth plate? A, growth hormone, B, leptin, C, thyroid hormone, D, glucocorticoids, and option E is none of the above. All right. You can see that people are voting. I'll relaunch the poll. I think the time was very less. Only few people have voted. I'll give some more time. Okay. So if I relaunch, I think the existing results will go on. So it's okay. Yeah. So most of them, about 56% have answered as leptin as a hormone which does not influence the growth plate, but unfortunately that is not the right answer. So leptin is one of the important hormones which is supposed to weaken the growth plate actually. So there are papers which have shown that it increases the width of the physis, it weakens the physis. It is associated with obesity actually. So it is said that in one of the papers they have said that the presence of leptin above a certain value increases the chance of SCFE for up to 5 times compared to the normal. So the correct answer here is none of the above actually. So all the hormones listed above influences the growth plate. Let's move to the next question. Which of the I have to end the poll. Stop sharing.
Click near the polling. There is a downward arrow. You can select poll 2.
I'm just trying to do that. I'm not able to do that.
Polling 1:1 on the top. There is a...
Yeah, I can see that. It's on the top. Okay. So I have to select poll 2 in that, right?
Yes. And you can launch it.
Yeah, I've launched it. I think most of you would have read the options by now and on my screen. So there is something called age weight test. So which of the following statement is true about age weight test? Option A is it is positive when age is more than 16. Option B is it is negative when the weight is less than 50th percentile. Option C is positive test is an indicator of typical SCFE. And option D is was described by Randy Loader. I'm waiting for people to vote. We have about 10 responses so far. So I request all the participants to vote. We have another 5 seconds. All right. So I'm going to end the poll and share the results with you. So 42% feels that it is a positive test is an indicator for typical SCFE. Right. So that is not the right answer. Actually, the true thing is it was described by Loader. That is the right answer. And only 1% has got it right. So it is basically to differentiate atypical SCFEs from typical SCFEs. So by atypical SCFEs, we mean that those associated with obesity, endocrinopathy, and other stuff like that. So whenever it is negative, the negative predictive value is said to be about 93%, right? So the correct answer is it was described by Professor Loader. So I'll go to the next poll now. Next question is this. Which of the following statement is false about epiphyseal tubercle. Option A, it is a peg-like structure from the metaphyses into the epiphyses. In a typical SCIFI, the epiphyses rotates posteromedially around the epiphyseal tubercle. Option C is it plays a role in the stability of the epiphyses. And option D is disengagement of the tubercle causes complete slip similar to acute unstable SCIFI. I request the participants to vote. I've launched the poll already. Nine responses so far, 10. Four seconds to go. And I'm ending the poll now. You can see the results. So majority, I mean, actually it's split up between B, C, and D, but all three are wrong answers. The correct answer, it is a peg-like structure from, actually it is from the epiphyses into the metaphyses. It is not from the metaphyses into the epiphyses. So other three are correct statements. Let's move on to the next question. All of the following are radiological signs of SCIFI except A, Trithoven sign, B, Sham sign, C, Steele sign, D, peritubercle sclerosis, and E is none of the above. Let me launch the poll. I'm forgetting to launch the poll all the time. So I've taken a lot of recent concepts in SCIFI just to make sure that you all get to know about the recent advances in this topic. So I'm going to end the poll now, another 2 seconds to go. Yeah. And most of them, around 50% of them have answered as peritubercle sclerosis, which is the correct answer. Actually, the radiological sign is peritubercle lucency and not sclerosis. Let's move on to the next poll, next question. Slip capital femoral epiphysis can cause all of the following except A, FAI, B, coxa valga, C, chondrolysis, D, AVN, and E, osteoarthritis. Ten more seconds to go. Right. Let me end the poll now and I'll share the results. And you can, as you can see, that most of them have got the right answer as coxa valga. So one can argue that coxa valga is a rare deformity in atypical type of slip. But in an exam, when you're given these options, the other options are much more common, and the right answer would be coxa valga. So let's move to the next and the last question. The reported complications following prophylactic pinning for SCIFI include all except A, chondrolysis, B, subtrochanteric fracture, C, C, A, V, N, and D, none of the above. Okay, let me end the poll now and share the results. About 50% of them have got the right answer as none of the above. 42% have opted as subtrochanteric fracture. Subtrochanteric fracture is a reported complication. And we know that chondrolysis is one of the common concerns when we are doing prophylactic pinning. But surprisingly, there has been reports of AVN. A few years back, there was a report of AVN following prophylactic pinning. So none of the above is the right answer. With this, we end the pre-test and let's move on to the session, main session today. On behalf of the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India, I welcome you all for today's lecture on slip capital femoral epiphysis. We are having the 10th lecture in the Posey Gurukul series, and we are very fortunate to have Dr. Kumar Amarendra Singh as our guru today. So he's a pediatric orthopedic surgeon. He did his fellowship from Manipal, and now he's a staff in Manipal. So he joined back the alma mater, and he's going to give us the lecture today on slip capital femoral epiphysis. Thank you, Dr. Amarendra, for accepting the invitation. And as Sadhgurus, we have two senior professors, Dr. Gopinath Menon from Chennai and Dr. Surendra Kamath from Mangalore. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation, and it's a pleasure to have you here, sir. And with this, I will stop sharing my screen and request Dr. Kumar Amarendra Singh to share his screen and launch the lecture.
Good evening, everyone. Am I audible now?
Yeah, you're audible. Can I request all the delegates to mute yourself so that there is no background disturbance? Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for this nice opportunity. In this session, we will be trying to understand something about the slip capital femoral epiphysis, which is many a times called by our seniors as adolescent coxa vara or SUFE, SUFE, that is slip upper capital epiphysis. So we should not get confused regarding the terms. All are same. All three are same. We are going to discuss the common clinical presentation of SUFE, the different terminologies and the classifications which are useful during the exam and in future practice, how to evaluate a child if you are suspecting SUFE, important radiological science and the science behind it, the different treatment options which are available and the treatment of choice for this condition. First of all, SUFE is a misnomer, which is a common thing which is asked in the exam. Why it is a misnomer? It is a misnomer because the epiphyses do not slip out of the acetabulum. It remains inside the acetabulum. It is the metaphyses, which migrates proximally and anteriorly, thereby leading to the slippage at the physis. So this is important to understand what is actually SUFE. We see that the head of the acetabulum, the head remains inside the acetabulum, whereas the metaphysis slips. That's why it is called a misnomer. These are the different important stabilizing fractures for the physis, the perichondral ring, the mammillary process, contour of growth plate, and all this. As the child ages during the adolescent period, the neck shaft angle reduces and the physis obliquity increases. when there is an imbalance between the shearing stress because of the weight of the body and the mechanical stability provided by all these factors, it can lead to the slip. When we take a history of a child regarding the slip, age is a very important factor. Most of these children are of the age of adolescence, like more than 11 years, 10 or 11 years. Many a times, the parents will complain of pain of varying duration, and most of the time, it is a dull type of pain. They may complain about the abnormal gait or a deformity or some inability, like inability to sit cross-legged or squat. So these are the primary things what they will complain in the history. We should keep in mind, if any adolescent is presenting with unexplained limp and pain is at anteromedial aspect of thigh and knee without any significant trauma, it can be slip. Many a times the referred pain can mislead us to another diagnosis. Most of the time, there's a dull type of pain which is of several weeks duration. The pain gets aggravated on physical activity and gets relieved with rest. The patient may complain of the limp, which is painful. In the disability, they may complain of disability to like squat and sit cross-legged because of the restriction of some movements. When we have finished our history of presenting illness and we go to the treatment history, it is important to identify whether the child has been supplemented with growth hormone or has been treated for thyroid dysfunction. Is the child having any renal problems, or whether the pelvis has been irradiated for any condition, because these are the risk factors for slip. Channel grading in general examination is important. Most of the times, as we discussed recently, that they may be obese, and the adiposogenital presentation many a times associated with SCFE. Though rare, but still, if the child is thin and tall, it can be associated with the slip, which occurs in the growth hormone abnormality. So if a child is adiposogenital or thin and tall, we should suspect if the child is having hormonal dysregulation. The gait is important thing. Okay, when we do a gait analysis, we concentrate how the patient walks, what is happening to the head, what is happening to the neck and shoulders, what is happening to the trunk, what is happening to the pelvis, how is the lower limb moving, what is happening to the foot progression angle, like we see in this video. The child is having a short stepping gait in this video. If you see the foot progression angle, the child, the foot progression angle is increased. If you see, there is a Tildenberg gait pattern is present. If the slip is moderate to severe, along with the Tildenberg type of gait, there may be shortening also. There will be short limb gait also. If both the lower limbs are affected, the child can have a waddling type of gait. Depending on the side of involvement, depending on the severity, the child can have Tildenberg gait associated with the short limb gait. On inspection, if you see here in this child, what is happening to the knee which is exposed? The knee on the left side is externally rotated. If we concentrate on the foot is also externally rotated. There may be wasting of the thigh muscles, especially in the cases of unilateral involvement. Also, if it is a unilateral involvement, there may be shortening on inspection. The anterior superior iliac spine on both the sides may be at the same level. So these are the important findings which we can expect to speak when we are talking about inspection. On palpation, there may not be any local warmth, but yes, tenderness may be present in the joint area. The greater trochanter in unilateral cases may be higher and posterior as compared to the normal size. In the end of the palpation, we comment about the deformity. These children will have an external rotation deformity and restriction of the internal rotation. We should remember that these children will be having an extension type of deformity at the hip. So the Thomas test is expected to be negative. But if an examination Thomas test is positive, please remember it may be a complicated SCFE when there is an intra-articular pathology like avascular necrosis or chondrolysis along with the SCFE. So we should remember that in SCFE, if it is not complicated, the Thomas test should be negative. There will not be restriction, or there will be restriction When we assess the movements, there will be increase in adduction, adduction, and restriction of abduction because of the coxa vara. When we talk about the other movement, there will be restriction of the flexion and increase in extension because of the femur retroversion. When we assess the rotations, there will be increase in the external rotation and there will be restriction of the internal rotation. Again, this is because of the femur retroversion. The terminal abduction and internal rotation will be painful. However, if the slip is acute, all the movements may be painful because of hemarthrosis. And many a times, if it is an unstable slip, it may not be kept in the exam. Again, Dreman sign will be positive. There will be obligatory external rotation with passive flexion of the hip and knee. This is what we call as an axis deviation. When we attempt to flex the hip, the knee will go towards the ipsilateral shoulder. Again, we should avoid doing this axis deviation test and make the patient walk. We should not do this in cases of unstable slips. During measurement, there may be acute or the absolute shortening of about 1.25 to 1/2 inch, that too in the supratrochanteric region, which we can assess with the Brand Strangle. There will be diffuse atrophy of the upper thigh depending on the severity, depending on the duration of the condition. Tenenberg will be positive in these patients. However, we should not do this in case of unstable slip. Telescopy will be negative and Galizzi sign might be positive, especially in the unilateral cases. So from the history, what we are going to find out or what we are going to comment from the history, we should document the age of the patient. Where is the pain, hip, knee, or the groin region? What are the associated history of the risk factors like hormone intake or hormone deficiency or a radiation therapy? And especially there will be pain on weight bearing. The signs which we will elicit in such a case is the antalgic gait, joint area tenderness on palpation, external rotation deformity, change of arc of motion because there will be increase in adduction and decrease in abduction, axis deviation on passive flexion of the hip, supratrochanteric shortening. If it is a unilateral case, it may be marked. Positive Trillenberg will be present, but there will be no or the negative telescopy. When this is over, then the commonest question which is asked in the exam, what are you going to do? And the first thing we are going to do is we are going to investigate the child to reach to a diagnosis. And the X-ray is the most important thing what we do in most, almost all the orthopedic cases. We take the pelvis with both hips, radiographs with AP view and the frog lateral view. Again, remember, frog lateral view should be avoided if we are suspecting unstable slip. We can take other views. You can see here, this is a AP view or the AP view of the pelvis with both hips. On the left side, we have seen the Klein's line, what is written there. If we draw a line along the superior surface of the neck of the femur, it will intersect the head of the femur. If there is a slip, in this case, it is a severe slip. If you draw the same line on the right side over the superior surface of the neck of the femur, it is not intersecting the head of the femur. This is called the Trithoven sign or the positive Trithoven sign. Now, we should remember that in mild slips, this line, that is the Klein's line, might be intersecting the head of the femur, but if the other hip is normal, the difference should be more than 2 millimeters. It can be considered positive Trithoven sign. Other thing, if you see this X-ray, the same X-ray, this is the margin. On the right side, we can see the margin of the head, and we can see the metaphysis of the neck. In this area, there is an overlap between the proximal part of the metaphysis of the femur and posterior part of the head of the femur. We can see there is a opaque area in this area, and this is called metaphyseal Blanch sign of Steele. On the other side, if we see, there is an overlap between the metaphysis of the proximal part of the femur and the posterior wall of the acetabulum. This region, this is present in the normal hip, and that is what is called the Sham sign. In the affected side, this will be absent. Okay, Sham sign will be absent. In the chronic slip, if you see on the left side, there is a bump on the anterosuperior portion of the neck. And this bump is what is responsible for blocking the abduction and medial rotation. At the same time, when we concentrate in the lower part of the neck, in the chronic sleep, there will be formation of callus. Southwick angle measurement is an important measurement, which most of the time when the X-ray is given to you, it is asked in the viva. And what is the normal value? How to draw this Southwick angle? We draw a line along the physis. We draw a line perpendicular to the physis, that's the second line. And the third line, we draw along the axis of the femur shaft. The angle which is formed by the line which is drawn along the axis of the femur shaft and the perpendicular line is what is the Southwick angle. It can be measured in AP and frog lateral, both views. In the frog lateral view, the normal value is approximately 10 degrees, and in AP view, it is about 145 degrees. So what we do, we use this Southwick angle for categorizing or grading the severity of the slip, whether it is a mild, moderate, or severe slip. How we do? We measure on the affected side, measure on the normal side, and subtract this angle from the affected side. The remaining is what we used for classifying the severity of the slip or for grading the slip. As seen in this radiograph, what we have done here, we have marked the two points or the ends of the physis, joined the line, and drawn a line perpendicular to the physial line. The third line is along the axis of the femur shaft, not the neck, along the axis of the femur shaft. And this acute angle here we see is 33 degrees. On the other side is 21 degrees. Both the sides, the angle is more than 10 degrees. So this is actually a case of bilateral slip. After the radiographs, just now we were discussing about the blood investigations. It is important to find out the metabolic or the hormonal abnormality in the patient. For that, we send the parathormone level, calcium phosphorus, alkaline phosphatase. We assess the renal parameters. We assess the level of the vitamin D and thyroid profile, and also the sex hormones, because this will help us to guide for the medical management of the child in the later in the course of the treatment. After the investigation, they ask for the classification. The classification, functional classification provided by Loder, that is what is widely acceptable and a very simple classification. He has classified SCFE into stable and unstable sleep. In stable sleep, the child will be able to bear weight on the affected limb with or without support. If the child is not able to bear weight on the affected limb, even with the support, it is an unstable sleep. It is very easy to distinguish. If the child is not able to bear the weight, it is an unstable sleep. If the child is able to bear it with any support, it is a stable sleep. This is important classification. Depending on the duration of symptoms, SUFI or SCFE can again be classified into acute, chronic, and acute on chronic. If the duration of symptoms is less than 3 weeks, it is an acute SCFE. If the duration of symptoms is more than 3 weeks, it is chronic SCFE. If the patient has got the symptoms for a longer duration, however, it has got aggravated in last 3 weeks, that is acute on chronic SCFE. This is a simple way to classify the SCFE depending on duration of symptoms. Other way grading, just now we were discussing, depends on the severity. Pre-sleep is a condition where there will be widening or rarefaction in the area of the growth plate. Many a times, the radiographs with the sleep, mild sleep, may be normal. And if we suspect a sleep, to confirm a pre-sleep, we need to do MRI. MRI will show the changes in the physial area. In mild sleep, the metaphysis slips less than one-third of the physis, or the head-shaft angle difference in the unilateral sleep is less than 30 degrees. If the angle is more than 30 degrees but less than 60 degrees, it is a moderate slip. Or if the metaphysis has slipped less than one-third of the physis, more than one-third of the physis, but less than half of the physis, it is a moderate slip. And more than this, that is, if the metaphysis has slipped more than half of the physis or the head shaft angle difference is more than 60 degrees in the frog lateral view, it is a severe slip. So, what is the aim of the treatment? We are going to treat, and what is our aim? What is happening? There's a slip is happening where the metaphysis is slipping on the epiphysis. Our goal is to prevent the progression of this slip to help in the closure of the capital femoral epiphysis. to help in the reduction of the epiphysis and to prevent the complications which we just now discussed about the chondrolysis, vascular necrosis, and the arthritis. This is a simple flow chart which will help you to understand the treatment. If it is an idiopathic sleep in an adolescent, how you are going to treat? That is the next question, important question, which is asked in the exam. These are the different treatment modalities which are mentioned in the book, ranging from in-situ pinning to spica cast application to open reduction and to different types of osteotomies. Out of all this, in-situ pinning is the gold standard, which you can tell for almost all the types of sleeps, in-situ pinning, so as to prevent the further progression and to help in early fusion of the physis. Open reduction of the epiphysis and the osteotomy at different level are other options which are available with us, especially in the cases of severe sleep. Open epiphysodesis with bone graft and spica cast application in isolation is rarely performed nowadays. In situ fixation with a single cannulated screw in the center of the epiphysis in both AP and lateral views is what is required in all these patients. We should avoid any type of reduction. That will be safest. How this in situ pinning is work? It is going to fix the epiphysis to the metaphysis and thereby it will prevent the further slippage. These are the different fixation devices which can be used, ranging from the screws to threaded pins and smooth pins. The advantage of threaded pin and smooth pin is, though it will prevent the slip, it will prevent the premature fusion also, and it can be used especially in very younger children. But at the same time, there is a risk that there will be high chances for further slippage. In situ fixation will give a good outcome and it will prevent the progression with minimal chances of chondrolysis if it is properly done. The next important question which is asked in most of the exams is, what is the distance between the tip of the screw and the subchondral bone? Please remember, it is by approximately 5 millimeter, which is regarded as a safe zone. Regarding the direction of the screw placement, we start anywhere near the intertrochanteric line, that is distal to the intertrochanteric line, and we aim perpendicular to the physis in both AP and the frog lateral views or the lateral views when we are operating inside the theater. What is the entry point? How we're going to help it? Whatever is the severity of the slip, we have to aim at the center of the epiphysis, not at the center of the neck. Now, there are some limitations of in situ pinning. There may be progression of the slip even after the internal fixation or in situ pinning. Even after the surgery, there may be risk of screw penetration and it may result in the complications. Now, progression of the slip is more common in unstable and acute slips. If you have operated a child and the child is having persistence of symptoms, persistent pain, please consider that there is a progression of the slip. Now, this progression of the slip is unlikely if about 5 threads have crossed the physis and has gone into the epiphysis. This is the commonest question which is asked by most of the examiners and asked by the parents. When are you going to remove the implant? It is not required to remove the implant. The implant can be left in situ. And if they're asking to remove the implant, please retain the fixation till the physial closure has been obtained. There are some limitations of in situ pinning, that is impingement of the screw head and impingement because of the severe slip. In case of severe slip, the screw head will be too proximal on the neck and the screw head will impinge on the labrum every time the child will flex the hip. This can lead to loss of flexion and forced external rotation. Like in this patient, if we see, this is the direction of the screw we are going to place and the bigger head will try to impinge towards the acetabulum every time the child will attempt to flex the hip. How this can be avoided? This can be avoided by using an oblique approach, by starting or having the starting point distal to the intertrochanteric line and making sure that the screw heads are flushed or in the bone. Also, we can consider the corrective osteotomy in moderate to severe slips to avoid this complication. These are the different corrective osteotomies which are available in case of moderate to severe slips that can be done at the level of the subcapital, at the level of basis cervical, or at the level of the trochanter. subcapital osteotomy, it helps in adduction, extension, and external rotation deformity correction by removing an appropriate wedge. This is a pictorial depiction of the procedure. With the safe surgical dislocation, we dislocate the hip. With the gentle hands and preserving the retinocular vessels, we displace the epiphysis. We remove a wedge of the bone from the metaphysis of the neck, having a base at the anterolateral aspect. The lateral base will help in improving the adduction, and the extension will be corrected by the anterior base. And we correct the rotation deformity by derotating the femur. After that, we place the epiphysis to the metaphysis and pass the screws, and then reduce the hip. This is a child who was treated with safe surgical dislocation and modified Dunn's osteotomy. Other option to correct this is by the subtrochanteric or intertrochanteric osteotomy, like in these cases. How it is going to help? Where is the deformity? The deformity is at the level of the physis. What are the deformities? The deformities are the varus, extension, and external rotation. So we create a deformity at the subtrochanteric level. The deformities are opposite to what is present at the physis. That is, instead of varus, we create a valgus. For extension, we create the appropriate amount of flexion. And for external rotation, we derotate and create an internal rotation to the neutral. Okay, to what is the acceptable position. This will help, but at the same time, there are some drawbacks also. This is a long-term outcome. This do not restore the anatomy. At the same time, there may be increased risk of impingement, which may persist. When the child is very young, less than 10 years, or if the child has got the endocrine or renal dysfunction, we can consider prophylactic pinning of the contralateral hip, because there is a high chance in these children that there may be slip in due course of time, which generally occurs about 1 to 1.5 years after the onset on the first side. This is another example where prophylactic pinning has been done on the opposite side. If it is an unstable slip is an emergency condition. What about doing the early open reduction in cases to reduce the physis? Past reports have not favored this outcome because of the complications, but with the use of the safe surgical dislocation, there is low rates of avascular necrosis. The advantage of safe surgical dislocation and modified Dunn's osteotomy is it helps in retaining or regaining the anatomical position. Acute unstable slip is an urgent condition. We should avoid doing any attempt for reduction. 1 to 2 screws can be used for fixation, and arthrotomy helps in decompressing the joint and thereby preventing the risk or reducing the risk of avascular necrosis. In this example, we can see it was an unstable slip and it has been fixed with single screw and 2 wires. What to do if it is an acute and chronic slip? Yes, in situ pinning is what can be done in the mild cases. But if the severe cases are there, as in this example, where there is an acute and chronic slip, the child developed pain, was having some deformity for a long time. The child was treated with a safe surgical dislocation and modified the osteotomy with a good outcome. Then they ask, what are the complications, associated complications with SCFE? We have just now discussed the complications. The first complication is chondrolysis. In a slip which is not treated, chondrolysis is rare. But the chondrolysis most of the time occurs when the screw penetrates the joint. So we have to be very careful where the screw head is going. Avascular necrosis is second important complication. It is more common with acute or unstable slip, or if there has been an attempt to reduce the slip. How this can be avoided? Avascular necrosis by careful pin placement. We avoid the entry of the pin in the posterior superior quadrant, because if it goes to the posterior superior quadrant, the main blood supply to the head of the femur will be cut off, will be compromised, and the head will land up in avascular necrosis. We can avoid attempting reduction of chronic slips, and we can decompress the joints, especially in cases of acute slips, to relieve the tamponade effect. For impingement, as we have just now discussed, we can use the oblique approach to avoid the impingement of the screw head. Or we can use the osteotomy at different levels, either at the level of the you know, subcapital or modified the osteotomy or at the intertrochanteric or the subtrochanteric level to restore the anatomy of the proximal femur. It is indicated, the osteotomy is indicated if the slip exceeds more than 45 degrees, because there is a high chance of impingement and subsequent labral injury and degenerative arthritis. Now, take home message is any adolescent with unexplained limp and pain at the anteromedial aspect of thigh and knee without any significant trauma, always suspect SCFE and keep the SCFE as a differential diagnosis. If the child is adiposogenital or thin and tall, suspect SCFE and hormonal irregularities. If there is an adduction, extension, and external rotation is increased with reduced movements of the hip, other movements of the hip, suspect SCFE. If the child is not able to bear weight, it is an unstable slip. Be careful. If there is a restriction of all movements of the hip joint, it is a complicated slip, complicated either by contralysis or a vascular necrosis. Radiograph of the pelvis is essential for diagnosis, and frog lateral view, it is very important. It is more important than the AP view, but it should be avoided if it is an acute slip. In situ pinning with single cannulated cancellous screw in center position with minimum 4 to 5 threads crossing the physis is the gold standard of treatment. So for any of the slip, if you tell in the exam in situ pinning, it is acceptable. Modified done procedure with safe surgical dislocation, it is very useful in the severe slip because it will prevent the impingement. Contralateral prophylactic pinning in a child with endocrine or renal anomaly, or if the age at onset is less than 10 years in girls or less than 12 years in boy, is what is indicated. Thank you.
Are you going to tell anything about this video, Dr. Amarendra?
In the first video, we see that the child is having a limp on the right side, sir. The child is, the foot progression angle, we can see it is more on the right side as compared to the left side. There's a lurch, pelvic lurch, you can see. There's a tendinopathic gait on the right side. And the second video shows the post-operative video of the same child after 2 years of surgery, where the foot progression angle has improved, the lurch has improved, and the child is comfortably walking with a normal stance and the swing phases on both the sides. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Amarendra, for a very lucid talk on slip capital femoral epiphysis, which covered almost all aspects of SCFE. And a special note of thanks for covering the clinical examination part in great detail with good videos, which is very important for the residents. Now I invite our sadgurus, Dr. Gopinath Menon and Dr. Surendra Kamat, to start the discussion and ask some commonly asked questions in the exam as far as slip capital femoral epiphysis is concerned. I know it's one of the common cases which is kept in exams. So I will ask a question to both of you, sir. So as far as the students are concerned, most of the times in exam, they get a chronic stable slip as a case. So whenever they get a chronic stable slip, irrespective of the severity, should they tell in situ fixation as the treatment of choice, or how is it? What is the expectation of the examiners these days? If the child is having impingement, in situ pinning is not going to relieve the impingement as such.
Correct. Now, if I may speak, so Dr. Menon here. Yeah. Yes, now, I think that question is an extremely valid question. If the child has come to you with a chronic slip, and if the symptoms are more of impingement or earlier or a femoral acetabular impingement, then I think just in situ fixation will not be the answer. So if that is there, then you will have to speak about safe surgical dislocation and bumpectomy, etc., as a treatment plan. So I think first and foremost, whenever the child is in a clinical scenario, when the child is examined during the examination, you have to not only decide One, whether it's acute or whether it's acute on chronic or chronic. Two, you will have to see the weight of the child, the age of the child, whether it's symmetrical, whether it's a single hip or bilateral hip. Is it associated with other medical issues like hormonal issues or thyroid problem, renal diseases, or other reasons, if at all there are any? And then, based upon the investigations alone, you should plan your treatment. Of course, your symptoms, if the impingement is the predominant symptom, and if the fracture, if the slip femoral epiphysis has united, and it's a bump which is responsible for all that, then I think in situ fixation should not be tolerated. So if the epiphysis has fused, then I don't think there's really any role for in situ fixation. So if the epiphysis is not united, and if impingement is not the issue, pain is the issue, then I think in situ fixation might be an answer. Still nowadays, I think earlier it used to always be the answer. Nowadays, based upon the severity of the slip, you might think in terms of a safe surgical dislocation. But by and large, I think the symptoms will decide. If it's a chronic slip, if impingement is a predominant problem and not pain, then you might have other problems also. There might be a labral tear or something like that associated with the impingement. There might be other reasons why the patient has pain. So in those cases, I don't think in situ fixation should be the treatment of choice.
Okay, so I think the postgraduate should make this point very clear. So just because we say that in situ pinning is the gold standard of treatment in slip capital femoral epiphysis, it does not mean that. So in any case, if you get in the exam, you can blindly go ahead and tell in situ fixation as the treatment of choice for every other slip you see. So it does not mean that way. So you should actually look into what is the pathology actually, what brings the patient to you, what is the cause for the pain, and then you have to address that particular complaint. So otherwise, if you are doing an in situ pinning, as Dr. Gopinath Menon said, if you do an in situ pinning in a severely healed slip, it does not make any sense. So let me bring about one more controversy, Dr. Surendra Kamath, sir. So what do you think, sir? Should we talk about osteoplasty in the exams where we do if the child is having a CAM type of impingement? So if the one of the options is to do a safe surgical dislocation and do a shaving of the bump or a bumpectomy.
Correct. So, if a patient presents with impingement.
Yeah.
If patients present with the impingement, CAM type of impingement with the most symptoms suggestive of that, probably I think in the exam nowadays, we do expect this osteoplasty, or sometimes even nowadays people are doing arthroscopically, both ways, open or arthroscopically, shave of the bump and reduce the impingement and improve the symptoms.
Okay. So this is another thing which Dr. Amarendra has not covered. I just wanted to bring that part also, because most often in the exams, they keep only cases which are either sequelae of slip capital epiphysis like FAI or chondrolysis. Yes, sir.
Correct. Yeah.
So do you have any other questions from the students? If you have any questions, this is the time to ask. And after this OSCE, I think there are a lot of questions pertaining to it. It has become very easy to get cases for the students to conduct exams. So if at all they get a case of Kiffy with chondrolysis, so that is also a possibility. So what should be the approach? Or avascular necrosis is a complication with Kiffy. So if they get a chondrolysis, as Dr. Amarendra told, that the patient will be having a deformity and stiffness. Most often it is a external flexion abduction, external rotation deformity, and a stiff hip. So in that situation, what are the management options the students would have to say in the exam? To both of you, one of you can answer this.
Yeah. Now, if the child has come to you with chondrolysis or a complication of or avascular necrosis as a possibility, then of course salvaging is the only way you can do something about the hip. So depending upon the age of the child, and because it's a child itself, salvage is the first attempt to do things. Now, it might be in the form of some, say, surgically distracting the hip to reduce the, in the case of chondrolysis, or in the case of avascular necrosis, medical therapy. And but the fact remains that salvage is an option which you will have to still consider because it's a child. Now, if the child has become older, and of course, if the child is not having severe symptoms, then you might tend to wait and watch. But if the child is symptomatic and the child is unable to do his or her normal activities and is not responding to conservative measures or surgical measures which are head retaining, then I think nowadays, so many of the examiners will accept a total hip replacement as a choice. But that's not the primary choice, of course. So if you say that the first step in a viva voce, I think many of the examiners tend to be put off. But by and large, you can tell them that, yeah, I will try all conservative measures, including medical therapy. I will try to rehabilitate the hip, distraction, etc., trying to remove the avascular necrosis and the avascular portion of the bone, trying to do a safe surgical dislocation, and trying to get the neck and the head restored to as reasonable extent as possible. And if all else fails, because at the end of the day, pain is something which has to be addressed. If the child is symptomatic and is painful hip, and is not responding to any of the other methods of treatment, the child is unable to do his normal activities, then I think you should not, at the end of say, okay, this child should wait for a total hip till the child is 40 or 50 years of age. So you might have to do that, but I would be very cautious when you put that to the examiner. Put it, when the examiner asks you, what next? What else can you do? What more can you think about? Now, if the child does not respond to this part of treatment, then at the end, I would suggest you can mention a total hip or a surface replacement. But otherwise, don't tell that as a first choice. Let the examiner know that you would like to salvage the hip rather than go for a total hip at initial stages. Yeah.
Okay. So when we were students, we used to, we have been taught that hip arthrodesis is one of the options when there is a complication and the hip cannot be salvaged. So is it still an option to be considered, or whether the students can say that hip arthrodesis is an option,
right,
or should we refrain from saying that?
Yes, I would think, to me, I would think, now if it's a bilateral hip, then obviously arthrodesis never comes into the contention, because you would not like to do an arthrodesis of both hips. But if it's going to be unilateral and it is unlikely the other hip is already, the epiphyse is already fused, and there's unlikely to be a slip occurring in the opposite side, then you might consider that. Depending upon if the child is older and has become an adult, then you might consider, depending upon his job status, his work responsibilities, and his standard of living, style of living, etc., and then decide on that. But if it's a bilateral hip, I would definitely tell you that you should not think in terms of a fusion of a bilateral hip, which is, I think, is not indicated. Okay. But yes, if it's a manual worker, for example, say a young adult who's a manual worker who is to do agriculture work, etc., in the fields, I think a total hip is just out of problem for that person. Or if he requires squatting, sitting cross-legged, he's a weaver by profession, and he says, my livelihood is based on weaving, I can do something, then you cannot probably do a total hip in those patients and try to expect a reasonable range of movements. So I think, yes, it has to be tailor-made for the patient. But yes, if it's bilateral, the answer I think will be no for an arthrodesis as a primary treatment.
Surendra Kamath sir, what do you think about arthrodesis? Do you accept or no? Sir, the, some people say that.
Yeah, as you rightly said, probably when you are postgraduate, you know, nobody would have accepted a total hip replacement. People would have gone more for arthrodesis. But I believe in the last 10 years at least, this is a forgotten technique. I don't think we have done any hip arthrodesis in the last 10 or 15 years. Theoretically, fine. But I think in practically considering, anybody would like to have some painless, stable hip mobile rather than, you know, painless, immobile, stable hip. So practically speaking, you know, in our set of people, at least, I think arthrodesis is not an option. So we would rather, as Dr. Menon said, postpone the hip replacement or with some salvage techniques. But if not, ultimately, I think we end up doing a hip arthroplasty.
So we have some questions from the students. So I think a couple of them have asked, what is the role of positional reduction in an acute unstable SCIFI? Some 2-3 of them have asked the same question. So what do you think, sir?
Positional reduction is just a misnomer if you ask me. Means, of course, it is a gentle attempt at some sort of reduction. And when you do that, if it's an acute phase, you may get away with it or may not get away with it. But I would think that if the slip is of higher grades, then you should not attempt to do that because you are more likely to produce avascular necrosis. To me, avascular necrosis is the most ultimate problem which the child can end up with. Now, even if the child has a slip capital epiphysis, which is vascular and united, we can subsequently do something for the child as a salvage operation. But if the child goes for an avascular necrosis, then the child salvage operations becomes extremely limited. So I would think that it's your prime responsibility as a treating orthopedic surgeon would be to ensure that the child doesn't go for an avascular necrosis. I think that's mandatory. That's what I would think is the first thing that you should like to avoid.
Okay. And there is one more question.
In
patients with endocrinopathy with SCIFI, where you have an open physis, can any medical therapy be offered along with surgery to hasten physial closure? I think it makes sense to yes, sir.
Yeah, if there is a known endocrinal problem like thyroid or a growth hormone, I think along with our orthopedic treatment, we have to address this endocrinal issue also. That is one of the consideration we'd always take into. But many times, I think we may not be able to get into it. But overall, I think if we know that it's a thyroid or a growth hormone or anything else, I think that has to be addressed along with the treatment of SLIP.
And putting it other way, should we evaluate for endocrinopathy in every other patient with SCIFI?
Yeah. I think whenever you suspect SCIFI with the endocrinal issue, like, you know, typical patient, we have to evaluate and treat the underlying issue also.
Okay.
If the child has, because these children, it's important to do a full-fledged clinical examination of the child as such. If the child has other features suggestive that the child may be, for example, obesity or a Tanner scoring, which is much lower than what is expected, then I think you should always think in terms that you have to rule out an endocrinopathy in these children. Or if there's a suggestion, because you will anyway try to rule out these causes before you treat it. And if it's bilateral, all the more so. So I would think if clinical examination suggests that the child may have other problems, if the Tanner scoring is also suggestive of a child having some endocrinic problems, then you should, I think, always do it. it's safer for me if you ask me if you do it. Because, for example, if you treat one side, the possibility of the other side going for the slip capital epiphysis still remains very high in these children. And the earlier treatment of that condition is likely to be beneficial. So I think, yes, you should evaluate the child, especially if it's a bilateral hip and if the clinical features suggest anything of that. So in a clinical exam, general clinical examination is equally important, I would think so.
One of the students has asked, should we follow the Bernice algorithm for treatment? Any thoughts on this, sir? I think...
Of course, it may be a little radical in many and most of the times. So I would suggest, as an examinee, you stick to the ones which are, it's in the examiner. The examiner is the ultimate. Let's accept that in an examination situation. So you stick to normal methods of treatment, common methods of treatment, the treatment methodology which you have seen, which is seen in the most common textbooks of orthopedics. I think sticking in that is more likely to get you away from all the problems. Of course, some examiner might like to ask you a little more, whether you are more aware of these things. When that comes, then you might go a little, he might go a little deeper into it. Then you might come out with some answer like that. But otherwise, by and large, I would suggest stick to the common methods of treatment seen in the common textbooks of orthopedics.
Okay, sir. So, do we have any other questions from the students? Amarendra, do you have any WhatsApp question on your mobile?
No, sir.
Okay. I'm just seeing if there are any other questions. So I think if there are no questions, we have come to the end of this session. I would like to thank today's guru and today's Sadgurus for being with us today. And a special word of thanks for Dr. Gopinath Menon, who kindly accepted to be here amidst this important family function scheduled tomorrow. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Surendra Kamath, sir. And thank you, Amarendra, for a very nice lecture.
Thank you,
and
sir.
I would like to thank all the other POSI fraternity, starting from Dr. Dhiren and Hitesh and others who have joined us today. And a special word of thanks to all the delegates who have joined the 10th Gurukul session today and made it a success. And finally, a word of thanks to Ashok Shyam and Ortho TV for sponsoring this event all the time. Thank you so much. And
bye bye.
Bye and good night for all of you. All of you stay safe. Thanks. And we are going through a very tough times. I hope it all ends well.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Surendra, sir. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah. Bye bye, sir.
Bye. Bye bye. Bye bye.
Bye bye. Bye, Menon, sir.
Bye, Hitesh.
Menon sir, how are you? Last time you came, your son had COVID. This time there is no problem.
No. He didn't have COVID actually.
I think before 6 months or so.
No. Fortunately, not till now. He's got a family function. We have a family function tomorrow. So that's what I was a little hesitant. But then I thought, this is something which I'll be doing in the evening. So I am happy to do that. So that's how I joined this.
Yeah, because last time your first session was also very useful. Like you really gave very practical tips to the students.
Only Dr. Menon, I have one comment. I did not do it with everybody, but I agree with you for the pediatric orthopedic that we need to do the modified Dunn or osteoclastoplasty. But in postgraduate exam, we see how they are safe, whether they can say they modified done. That was the issue.
I think because somehow, although it has become quite common amongst pediatric orthopedic surgeons, it's not as common as in other countries. But of course, they are doing safe surgical dislocations for other conditions as well. So I think you wait you go step by step as far as the examination goes. You give an answer, early answers which are more, and then the examiner finds you answering well, then he asks you any other method, anything else which you can do, and then proceed to that. I would think that's a safer way in the examination.
Because
you want to please the examiner also.
Because some of the time what happened in the Western, the study came from the sick kids, the complication is as high, and the trained person and untrained person. So sometimes it would not be very safe. Either way, it's okay. I did not interrupt, but
Hitesh, that is why we did not say that we should we shouldn't say in situ fixation. In situ fixation is still the gold standard, but whenever we have situations like severe slip where the physis is healed, the student should not go and say that there is an in situ fixation option for in situ fixation. That's what we wanted to make it clear to the students.
That's correct. It's good. It's a good sense.
Thank you very much. Bye. Rajay Kumar, Ulkinder, Achan, off to the interest. Thank you. Thank you.